And welcome here to the Miller Grove Shot Clock League. We appreciate you joining us. Though we're getting a slow start here, it's for a good cause. Just got done touching base with Coach James Hartree of Tucker High School, as well as Coach Martise Troop of North Clayton High School, about the upcoming ATL Peach Elite Series, 13 of the top events in Georgia, ATL area specifically. But before we look too far ahead up the dashboard, let's look right here on the court. Will, we've got a matchup between Cedar Shoals and Shiloh.
Oh yeah, Shiloh Generals and the Cedar Shoals Jaguars both starting fantastic records last year, specifically Cedar Shoals going 29-3 and just beating the hometown team Miller Grove, who's won 6 of the past 7 state championships last week in this league. So it's going to be a pretty intriguing matchup, although you did mention a slow start. It will pick up here with the shot clock and everything. But some great talent on the floor. Look out for number 20, Josh Okoji of Shiloh, number 14, Dejon Waters. And you can look at number 13, Quinn Jarvis Hall, and also Philandris Fleming of Cedar Shoals. They'll be sure to put on a great show for you.
Nice take to the rack there by the big fella for Shiloh. Lee, that was number, I see his number once he turns back around. That's number 14. Dejon Waters. So Waters makes it 2-3.
Yeah, you see both teams trying to play a little in and out basketball. Not really working too well down the post right now, but we're only halfway through the first half, so I looked for both teams to stick with their game plan, although it's early. But, you know, nice rebound there by Shiloh. That was number 12, Tosh Fraley. And while we get to the second media timeout of the game, we'd like to let you know that today's webcast is sponsored by the Team EAT 4th of July Tip-Off Classic, July 3rd through 5th in Conyers, Georgia, and the Foundation Hoops Academy in Douglasville, Georgia, an elite training group helping players prepare for the next level. For more info, go to www.foundationhoops.com. Foundation Hoops Academy, build your game.
You saw Coach Rivers there on that last timeout, giving his team an earful. It's always nice to see the coaching adjustments taking place pregame, in-game, and postgame here at the Shot Clock League. There we take a look at the Jaguars huddle as well. I like covering tons of basketball, different schools, different areas. Athens area's representatives always get a great deal of support because, you know, you talk about Atlanta and obviously the stage that it can offer. You've got a lot of teams coming from areas like Athens, South Georgia, Columbus area, areas that have ball players that are just as good but might not have the same exposure. So it's always fun to see programs that kind of have the city on their back, so to speak, in terms of representing their area.
Oh, I couldn't agree with you more, and specifically the Athens area. We know Athens is pretty much dominated by football, so it's nice to see some of these teams get the respect and the exposure that they deserve. I mean, like you said, Cedar Shoals went 29-3 last year.
At 29-3, you looked at them. They definitely represented Athens well. You looked at Laney High School and the Wildcats. They're out of the Augusta area. They had a great season. I believe they were 29-2. Fell just short to Morgan County and Tukey Brown. But a good season for those guys. Waters with another bucket.
So, Marcus, I got a question for you. I incorporated this hashtag this morning, hashtag MGSCL, if you want to get involved with the action. And I have a fan that tweeted out, what prospects from the game might we see at the next level and why? And if you want to follow him, it's JWatt_Vols.
Yeah, that's a great question. I say one of the players that you could definitely see at the next level plays for Shiloh, Josh Okoji, number 20. There, as you see him positioning, going across the line. He's a guy, you know, you talk about motor. He's one of those guys that has a motor that's destined for the next level. He does the little things, and as he continues to develop his skill, you know, whether it be shooting, being able to handle, create his own shot, you'll really be able to see that young fella take off because his energy level and productivity are already there. That's just one, Will. That'll be a conversation we go back and forth to when you look at the Cedar Shoals side of things. You got Philandris Fleming, Quinn Jarvis Hall, also players that you'll see playing some college basketball.
Yeah, right when you say that, Philandris Fleming knocks down another three ball.
Makes it 6-4. I think a big thing is too many times, especially for those, you know, outside and inside of the game, if it's not, you know, one of your Kentuckys, North Carolinas, your Dukes, you have people that sleep on other colleges that might be a good fit for different players and skill levels. Playing at the next level goes everything from NAIA, JUCO, even if it's just a temporary stop, all the way up to D3, D2, D1 levels. So I think it's all about fit. And at the end of the day, while everybody would love to, you know, possibly be a pro ball player, look at the numbers on who actually makes it. So if you can play at the next level, get your education paid for, that's what it's all about.
You know, I'm glad you said that, because even this past yesterday, actually, at the Atlanta Entertainment Basketball League, I saw a couple faces I knew, actually, from my alumni at Georgia College, specifically Aaron Robinson. He's expanding his career right now. He played at Georgia College, had his education paid for, got the next level experience, and now he's taking his career to the next level. So you don't always have to go D1 to get the high competition basketball and the high intensity basketball. You can go, I mean, look at the NBA. A lot of the guys in the NBA, although a good majority of them went to big D1 schools. Some of them went to junior college and transferred into a school. But, I mean, any basketball at the next level is going to benefit you.
Couldn't agree with you more. You see Josh Okogie talked about his continuous development. You see him knocking down that jumper there on that last possession. But, you know, basketball is such a vehicle, and it goes beyond just the, you know, just black and white instances. You know, it's a lot of players that are able to use the game to not only be able to do well at whatever level they make it at, but, you know, it's really applicable to life overall, just as far as the work that goes in, the edge that you got to have, the shape that it requires. So whether you go on to coach or whether you go on in a different discipline or career, there's always elements that it teaches you along the way. So, you know, basketball never stops. It's more than just a popular Nike slogan. I think it's something that's very true and yields its head in a lot of aspects of life. But now that I'm done with the chicken soup for the soul, we've got a pretty good game here with Cedar Shoals and Shiloh. As you can see, both teams starting to get a little loose. Gonna be a blocking foul called here. Good sportsmanship shown there, as you'll get a quick assist up by Philandris Fleming. You can be that nice also when you know you've got plenty of buckets to come as the game goes on.
Oh yeah, nice tape there by Fleming at the top of the key, giving a nice little spin move at the free throw line, getting to the rack and drawing the foul.
You see Fleming and Hall, what they do a good job of is knowing when they can get their shot, but also playing good team ball. That's what the Jaguars do. Saw them do it there in their victory over Miller Grove. You know, it's nice to be able to have that gift of creating your own shot, being able to knock down the three ball. It's even better to balance it out and play team ball, moving it around. Three from the corner. That one's off the mark. Good contest there. Waters got out on that one. Okogie gets it ahead. SWAT team caught on the inside. The volleyball spike. On the inside there by Fleming, but there's a foul on the second effort.
Man, that was just great, great out-end transition offense by Shiloh. Right when they got the rebound, all bodies were heading the other way. Josh Okogie with the outlet pass at half court finds the big man down low, which is number 12, Taj Fraley, who's been a name that we've actually caught a lot during this shot clock lead.
It's just a win-win for all involved. You know, not only are the players able to get better, you see the officials able to get some reps and some games, but then also, you know, just the learning situations that teams have in this league. We've seen teams go up early and have to hold on to a lead after a team makes a run. We've seen the game get ugly early and teams have to fight and find a way to get back in there. So plenty of learning opportunities here for all of these players.
Yeah, and not to go unnoticed, the competitiveness too, excuse me. We've seen a lot of these games go down to the wire, as you see another close one here with 4:10 left, the Cedar Shoals heading to the line. But all teams competing, they want to win because they're competing. They're competing against the best competition within the state, and they know that they're probably going to see each other one way down the road. No matter if it's the state championship or somewhere in a regional tournament, but to get that experience and kind of get the game plan together really helps benefit them.
Yeah, one thing that interests me is, you know, some are for the shot clock, some are against it. We haven't seen it affect the game that much outside of the first week or so.
Yeah, not at all.
You know, the only thing it's really affected is that towards the end in crunch time, teams can't come down and hold it for 2-3 minutes. But outside of that, you know, these players have had a pace and a tempo to where shot clock violations really haven't been an issue.
I think they could even play with a 24-second shot clock, really. But, I mean, 35 is plenty enough for these teams.
Here's a Koji with it. puts it on the deck. Chooses to go right hand on the left side. He's fouled on the play. So that's going to send Akoji to the line.
Akoji is just one of those players that you always have to keep an eye on no matter where he is on the floor.
If you don't know where he is, 9 times out of 10, he's either scoring it or snatching a rebound and getting a putback. The guy never stops moving. Does a great job of running the floor and being productive. He's one of those guys that can get 20 points without having any plays ran for him, just off of strict hustle and being able to finish.
Nice pump fake and drive to the dish there by number 7 of Cedar Shoals, Arthur Jones, from the perimeter. Got his man in the air and took it hard to the big man down low. I think Jones was looking for a free throw there, but the referee is going to say it's going to be inbounding from under the baseline.
Talk with Coach Hartree of Tucker before this game. Tucker and Miller Grove, not in the same region now, but a serious rivalry here in the state of Georgia in past years. And Cedar Shoals, no stranger to rivalries. I say their in-town rivalry with Clark Central is always one that those in Athens and outside of Athens know of.
And you look at Tucker's, I mean, not even their recent success, but their storied program behind Coach Hartree, and you wonder why they keep producing such great teams, because, I mean, who wouldn't want to play for Coach Hartree?
Yeah.
Such a great coach, a humble guy. Really gets after his players and makes them better. And one of the top all-around coaches, not even in the state of Georgia, but I don't even go as far as the nation.
Yeah, great coach. That type of spirit and fight is infectious, and you always see his teams reflect them. Two good coaches here in this one as well. The staff for Cedar Shoals, they do a great job getting buy-in from their players, playing great team ball, and also Coach Rivers there at Shiloh. I'll make the comparison. You know, a few years back, Coach had Robert Carter, who's now at Maryland, the talented forward, had him on his roster. Also had Trayvon Reed, the 7-footer. Jordan Gaither was a pretty good player at the time. And I'd say that Shiloh team that they had last year was a better overall team. They didn't necessarily have the headliners in a Carter and a Trayvon Reed, but in terms of the way they played ball, sometimes less can be more when it comes to team chemistry.
Yeah, nice rebound there by Masterberg under the basket to rip it away from Fleming. Give it to his guard and out in transition, and now they're going to draw a foul and go to the free throw line.
While they go to the free throw line, we'll take a quick look at an instant replay. Talked about Josh Akoji.
Like we said before, you can't leave him open. You know, Yeah. You can't leave him open. He's going to knock that down all day long. Spot-up shooter. Not only is a spot-up shooter, he's got quick feet and he can easily take it to the rack.
And when a guy like that can fill the box score in so many other areas and get you the blue-collar buckets and blue-collar plays as well, when he's hitting jump shots and doing other things, it's just like, you know, it's like playing with house money, which is always a bonus. He comes back, gets the steal there. The General's looking to run. A little bit of a hesitation, leaves that one just short. Nice bounce pass. That was one of those layups where the player was a little more focused on slapping the glass than making the layup. Been there, done that. Not proud of it, but I think we've all done that a time or two.
I remember the first time I could actually touch the backboard on a layup. It made me so happy for some reason. It was like in eighth grade. And that one time I could finally touch the backboard on a layup, it just made my day. I don't know why, but it was just something you see at the next level, and you just kind of want to reenact it.
Man, eighth grade freshman year, man, just slapping the glass was the equivalent to a windmill dunk.
Oh, man,
in my book.
No.
That was enough for me to point to the heavens, man. A minute 32 left to play here in the first half. 4-point game. Shiloh, their first game of the day. Cedar Shoals, this is actually their second game today. Got to check the schedule. I know they've been here twice to be certain, and I'm pretty sure each time they had two game slates. Did Cedar Shoals, so definitely making the most out of that trip.
Yeah, Cedar Shoals played Tucker at 4 p.m. earlier today.
Trying to work it inside. Big fella needs a lifeline, so he'll kick it out. 2 seconds on the shot clock. They'll get it off. No good. Nice defense there by the Jaguars. They'll push the other way. Knocking it down there from the outside. That's number 10. Stavion Stevenson.
And right when you say that, Fleming with a monster block off the backboard, getting back on defense, swatting away number 33, Khalil Richard, under the block.
We talked about blue-collar plays by Koji on the Shiloh side. Stavion Stevenson specializes in that area for Cedar Shoals. Does a lot of the dirty work, whether it's rebounding or on the defensive end, to be able to create some of the opportunities and possessions that you see Fleming and Hall and some of these talented guards for Cedar Shoals take advantage of. So we're going to take a quick break. Appreciate you joining us here on SUV TV. We'll be back at the Miller Grove Shot Clock League after this word from our sponsors. Welcome back from the timeout. Marcus Burnett joined by Will Marlowe here on SUV TV. We've also got Nigel Pruitt here on the production staff as well. Appreciate you joining us for another day at the Miller Grove Shot Clock League. The venue hosting is the home court of six-time state champion Miller Grove. A lot of teams coming here with the end goal of this season being a state championship. Plays like that will help you get one, young man, as that's a nice way to end the quarter there for number 33 for Shiloh. That is Khalil Richard. So we're going to go into halftime, but not before we take a look at how Khalil Richard chose to end it. Gets him with the crossover, hesitates, stops on a dime, and knocks that one down. Who says the mid-range is a lost art? Khalil Richard finds it there as we go into halftime. We'll be back after this intermission.
And we're back here at the start of the second half. Shiloh leading Cedar Shoals 16-12. Took 4 minutes to get a bucket in this game, but midway through the second half, pace started picking up as a two ball is knocked down there by Cedar Shoals. Dejon Waters going the other way with it, taking it hard to the basket and drawing the foul.
As you can tell, Cedar Shoals, they didn't have dead legs there in the first half, but they were still trying to, you know, kind of get used to the flow of the game. Things weren't falling as much as they normally fall for those guys, but they were still in pretty good shape and striking distance. I think they're going to have a hotter offensive half here in the second half.
Free throws missed and rebounded by Philandris Fleming. Dishes it to Jarek Mitchell. Back to Fleming at the top of the key. A lot of movement from Shiloh right now. As an errant shot is rebounded there by, Cedar Shoals is rebounded there by Shiloh. Okoji spots open for the open three. Buckets, nothing but net. Second three of the ball game for Josh Okoji.
Shooting it well here today.
I mean, we just cannot stress it enough. You just leave Okoji open, he'll make you pay all day.
You got to be able to do that. Obviously you would appreciate a Steph Curry, a Klay Thompson, a Kyle Korver, a guy that can hit with a hand in his face. And for those of you saying which one doesn't fit when I mention Curry, Thompson, and Korver, leave our ATL Hawk alone. But but you like to be a guy that can be able to hit with the hand in the face. We see a nice little coast-to-coast move there. Good-looking play there. Who was that for Shiloh?
Khalil Richard again taking it coast-to-coast.
Richard with a real nice bucket there, but you like what you see from players that can knock it down with a hand in the face, but you appreciate the guys that can also knock down an open shot. You look at that Warriors series where they went up against the Grizzlies, you had an instance to where Steve Kerr was just daring Tony Allen to take that shot. Mm-hmm. And while Tony Allen's a great defender, he wasn't able to knock down that jumper. And so you saw what can happen when you fail to knock down the open shot. As we get a quick dap from Coach Charmin White. We appreciate him taking a time to come by the broadcast booth. Coach back in town after USA Basketball takes home the gold there versus, I believe it was Canada in the gold medal game.
Yeah, they took down Canada in the championship, took down, I want to say, Argentina in the semis before beating Brazil. And you can go look up all that stuff online. But the game recaps, I mean, USA pretty much blew most of the teams that played out of the water, finishing the tournament 5-0 and taking back the gold to America.
Yeah, Coach and a lot of their staff talked about the selflessness of that squad and just how it was really all about the win, how they got so much better. And, you know, obviously, if you're in the running for USA Basketball, talent's not really a question. That's there. I think the basketball acumen and some of the intangibles in terms of playing with the team and playing with other guys on your level against the best from other countries, that's what really shows, how the cream rises to the top in terms of international competition.
Oh, yeah, and you look at the next level with these teams bringing in all these superstars onto their teams now. I mean, it takes a year or two for them to really get their mesh together and work as a team when you have superstars playing. I mean, because obviously if you're on the Team USA, you got superstars across the board, but you really got to learn how to play with each other in order to win the game.
Yep. 15-21. Shiloh makes a substitution. 6-point advantage for the Generals. Also, we'll have one more webcast here today at 8 p.m. It'll be Miller Grove versus Jonesboro. It'll be a good game regardless with as hard as both of those teams play, but.
Oh, man, that's just great defense there by Okoji guarding the inbound. That long, long, leaping arms of Okoji. If he's guarding the inbounds pass, you got to predominantly just use a bounce pass because it's going to be hard to throw it over him. Nice take there by Shiloh. Shiloh really getting to the rim hard today.
Big man finish on the inside there. That was number 14. It's Waters. Deep three-pointer. Good contest there by Okoji. All going to be knocked out of bounds. It'll go back over to Shiloh. If you're Quinjarvis Hall and Philandris Fleming, they're having good games so far, but not the game that they want. But those guys just got to keep shooting. They're taking shots that are within the offense. They're not just coming down jacking it. And Shiloh's doing a good job of keeping their hands in their faces. You can't give those guys any kind of looks. Fleming tries to step through there. Part of that was maybe not the best decision on the break. Part of that was the legs after that earlier game.
Yeah, we've seen the pace pick up in this game. And like you noted before, Cedar Shoals already coming off a game we played earlier today. The legs might be getting a little tired now that the game's wearing on a little bit.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see how Cedar Shoals can adapt to the – because like we said, Shiloh really likes to get the rebounds and go, go, go.
Risky backpedal there. That was good awareness because he could have easily caught that ball and backpedaled right into the backcourt.
Yeah, you always got to be careful with those backcourt passes. Nice SWAT team, baby. That's number 12 for Landris Fleming, protecting his rim, swatting that over into the candy. Looks like the candy booth, candy table.
That's another thing these guards and wing players for Cedar Shoals are going to do. They can score, but they're going to get back on the defensive end as well. They're denying that pass on the inside. That one's knocked out of bounds. Okoji passes it in, comes back in and gets it. Now he'll follow a shot. Can't cash in on the 2-for-$1 opportunity on the shots. And instead it'll be Cedar Shoals coming the other way, still facing an 8-point deficit.
Okoji, although he missed a shot, he's getting the open looks that he wants. And he was the one that actually inbounded the ball, came off a pick and found himself open on the wing. It's like we all know, shooters are going to shoot. They're not all going to drop, but if you keep on shooting, hopefully they will, and that's what Josh Okoji's doing.
Nice ball movement. As the shot clock goes off, they got that shot off in time, and that's a good look. If you're coach there for Cedar Shoals, no complaints there with that shot.
No, not at all. They worked the shot clock down all the way to the last tick, moved the ball around, got their offense going. Nice shot there by number 3, Khalil Richard, yet again, putting the Shiloh team on his back up 25-15 here with 9:30 to go. Oh, Cedar Shoals has to be, they got to be careful with that. That's a 12 for Landris Fleming dribbling in the backcourt. The ball getting pretty high up near his neck. Could have been called for the carry.
And the Jaguars in a little bit of a predicament because they're down. The shots aren't falling as much as they would like them to. And then those, you know, this being their second game, you can see the effect in the legs. They're making no excuses. We're not making any for them either. But it definitely plays a role. And what's tough is if they can, you know, find a way to get some stops and score, not only is it going to be extra conditioning, it's going to be a very good comeback against a Shiloh team that's a little bit fresher in the legs category right now.
Oh, yeah, this one's far from over. We saw Jonesboro come back from 18 down a couple weeks ago. Right around this mark, they're down 16-18, came back and won the game. But Cedar Shoals shot's really not falling right now, and it's pretty hard because they're trying to work it down low like we just saw. But the long lengthy of you got you got Josh Okoji down in the block, you got TJ Massenberg, and those guys aren't going to let them get easy buckets down there.
But you know what can be one of their favorite, one of their best friends right now in this game with 9:06 left? That charity stripe right there, being able to go and get to the free throw line. And what that will give way to is what one of our producers, Nigel Pruitt, just alluded to, and that's that three ball, because if you can see the ball go through the rim a little bit at the free throw line, score without the clock moving, and be able to catch a breather while you're there, you'd be surprised the dividends that can yield in the area of the three-point shot.
Oh, yeah, it could get your shot going. Gives you the confidence once you see the ball fall through the hoop, like you just said. And it can really establish other parts of the game. You feel good from the free throw line. You feel like your shot's falling. Gives you more confidence to take further and deeper shots, which really what Cedar Shoals needs right now, down 8 with 8:52 to go.
Make no mistake, you know, the glass is definitely half full if you're Cedar Shoals. The ball's not falling as much as you would like it to, but you're only down 8 points with plenty of time left with 8:52 in the tank. Catch and shoot. Too strong on the shot. Be last touch by Shiloh. Go over to Cedar Shoals. Fleming Got it over to Jones. Now back up top to Flinney. Jones trying to save it. Can't keep it in bounds. I think here, obviously, you want Fleming and Quinn Jarvis Hall to kind of get going. I think two players that will be key to that are number one, Jarek Mitchell, as well as number seven, Arthur Jones. Those guys do a good job of creating opportunities for Fleming and Hall. And while you see those guys trying to get loose, nothing can give you energy like players like Jones and Mitchell, maybe coming up with a turnover or two, creating some wide open looks for those guys.
Yeah, we see some great defense here too in this ball game too. Both teams started off a little sloppy. You know, it took about 4 minutes for us to get some points on the board, but that can really be credited a lot to the defensive side of the ball as well. Josh Okoji having to really create his own opportunities. You look at Fleming and Hall, like you just mentioned, and Cedar Shoals really having to work the shot, really working the shot clock these past couple possessions. As the shot goes up and rebounded by Cedar Shoals, that's number 23, Chris Gresham with the offensive rebound and the putback. But these guys really getting after it on the defensive side of the ball.
Yeah, both teams are being stingy. I think some of this is good team defense on both sides, but you look at Fleming not really being able to get going. I think Josh Okoji's individual defense has played a big role in that as well. He's a solid defender. If this were the old NBA Live, he'd have that padlock next to his name in terms of the player rating. Trying to get the three ball rating. He's knocked it down, but can't get that one to go.
You know, Shiloh, although they have missed the last couple jumpers off the inbound, they're really getting the plays that they want off the inbound. And Josh Okoji find himself open on the past three inbounds under the hoop as Shiloh gets called for a reach-in foul.
Fleming there, still attacking, fouled on the floor. Telling you, Chief, I think it comes down to Mitchell and Jones creating for others, or just penetrating, being able to get it up on the glass and seeing what they can do with offensive rebounds, or knocking down a few shots to maybe take some of the pressure off of a Fleming. They're going to have to serve as a spark plug of some sort. They turn the ball over there.
Yeah, you can see some Cedar Shoals heads hanging a little bit. Maybe they're tired from the previous game, but a lot of these guys are playing AAU ball. And as we know, when they play AAU ball, they play multiple games in a day. So I want to say that a lot of these guys are used to the stamina aspect of it. But you see in this league, these players are really getting after it with the high-profile competition and the teams that have previously won state tournaments. They made it deep in the state tournament. Nice pass there from Fleming. Dishes it number five, Giovanni McDavid. Nice one-handed bounce pass from midcourt. Cedar Shoals getting back on defense, too. That's Mitchell with the steal. Like you just noted, Jarek Mitchell really going to have to try to spark this Cedar Shoals comeback, and now they only find themselves down 25-23.
That's one of the things that it'll take. You know, it can be with those guys having to score it or being able to get a quick turnover and turning some defense into offense.
Yeah, and another great defensive play there by Chris Gresham getting all on Okoji's grill. As Cedar Shoals gets called for the foul, that's going to send number 11 from Shiloh Perry Battle to the line.
You know, as Battle goes to the line, we're talking about Fleming and Hall still trying to get going. That young man right there, the one spot, Jarek Mitchell, still in the layup drill on the other end. They need a spark plug. Mitchell says, no worries. I got you. They made it a one-possession game. They missed on those free throws, but now if you're Cedar Shoals, what you don't want to do, you don't want to give them these extra opportunities. You worked so hard. You've gotten back in the game. You definitely don't want to give them freebies or additional opportunities on the offensive end.
No, not at all, but that was great effort and Great hustle there by Shiloh. Diving on the floor to save the ball and getting points out of it. As a coach, you always have to love seeing your guys give up their bodies to either save a possession or to get some points on the board.
Yeah, you love the authentic hustle. I know we've all seen that guy to where the ball is a good 3 feet out of bounds. It's already landed out of bounds. It's already in a pack of nachos. But this guy does a full body dive out of bounds. You know, it's one thing to hustle. It's another thing to DTM. I know we've all seen that guy before.
The Matthew Dellavedova factor.
Yeah. Yeah, Deli played hard, man. That guy played hard. Were some of those plays dirty? Maybe. You know.
Play hard, though. I mean, look at him. He was always giving. That's really what he was known for. I mean, for those first couple games, giving his body up. Then he had that third game where he had 20 points. But he was really getting after on the defensive side of the ball, shutting Steph Curry down. And it's really key for these guys to take a notice because you don't always have to get spotlight on the offensive side of the ball. Matthew Dellavedova really gained his spotlight from playing hard defense.
Yeah. Got under the skin of a lot of players in the process. And we knew it was going to be a good matchup because as hard as Dellavedova played, Curry said, I tell you what, I appreciate that hard work, but it's only going to get you so far. Talent really took over in that matchup as Curry was able to torch him there in those last few games. I mean, he played great defense. I mean, some of those shots that Curry hit, you could put in any other defender in that place as a placeholder, and I'm not sure there would have been any different outcome. If he's on, he's on.
And stamina-wise, I mean, he hadn't really played he played before, but he hadn't played the amount of minutes that he was really playing in the playoffs. But he was going at it the whole entire time when he was on the court. Really playing hard defense, like you said, getting under Steph Curry's skin, forcing up those errant shots that, I mean, we know Steph Curry can make and we've seen him make, but he's not going to make all of them, especially with the hand in his face.
They say Deli was dehydrated, I believe. I think that was after the game four. And he had to cut those cups of coffee at halftime. You can tell he's used to being in Cleveland. Give him one summer here in Atlanta, he won't even think about a cup of coffee there during this time of year. Playing volleyball around the rim, persistence paying off on the offensive end. The offensive rebound and tip in there by Shiloh.
Yeah, just as Cedar Shoals climbs back in the game, Shiloh goes on a 7-0 run. Nice in and out basketball being displayed as Fleming throws up the three, nothing but backboard. But it's going to stay Jaguar ball with 18 ticks left on the shot clock.
Even if Cedar Shoals can't come back and get this game, their legs are going to be jello getting back on the bus. Good day for conditioning. Plus, they're continuing to play hard. Fleming says, if I go down, I'm going to go down shooting.
Like we said, shooter's going to shoot. Got to find their way around the rim. Fleming knocks down the open three, trying to lead this Cedar Shoal comeback.
Take a look back at that last one now. They've gotten a little bit, you know, a little bit sleep on that one. They've done a good job of making sure Fleming hasn't had any open looks. Did not let that lead fool you. There's a shot clock in this game. There's 4 minutes and 25 seconds left, so plenty of time left for Cedar Shoals to come back in this one. You go into that timeout right after Fleming seeing a splash go through. We'll see if that ignites something here for Cedar Shoals. We look back. We talked about the need for a catalyst in the form of a Jerick Mitchell or an Arthur Jones. Mitchell got a scoop and score. And it's been good momentum in favor of Cedar Shoals, but Shiloh has bent it at different times but have not broken just yet. As a matter of fact, they responded with the spurt each time they needed to.
It's number 33, Khalil Richard walking up the court for Shiloh. Okoji with the quick hesitation and knocks one down from the charity stripe. We've seen a lot of that pump fake, one dribble into the shot from Josh Okoji is one of many things that he can do. Okoji with the ball right now, going hard to the rack, laying it in with the right hand off the right side of the glass. 37-26 ball game here, 3:45 to go.
Looks like Shiloh used that timeout, got back to business. As they continue to extend this lead, nice answer there by Cedar Shoals. The shots that Okoji has had here in this game, it's all been what the defense has given him. Just, you know, economy of motion, just basic moves. He's not doing too much, not doing a ton of dribbling, letting the ball stick, being very deliberate out there. Nice job of catching the ball in traffic and finishing there by the big man for Shiloh.
Yeah, fantastic touch pass there by Khalil Richard. I don't even think the big man was really even looking for the ball. He just went up with his left hand, somehow found the ball in his hand, goes up for the easy bunny. As Fleming spots up for another three, misses it, and there's going to be a foul under the basket.
And that was T.J. Massenberg with the finish on the other end for Shiloh. What's good, you know, as a big fella, you got to be able to roll to the rack. And sometimes you're rolling with the intention of being able to rebound and get it done. But like you said, sometimes, you know, anytime you're playing with solid guards, you're going to have some passes that just land in your lap. You got to be able to catch that and finish. And that's one of the things I think the Super Soft Camp, it was fun to be able to watch that camp and some of the camps we've covered, because you see post players that have obviously earned a following or enough reputability to get that type of invite, but they're not always used to playing with the caliber of guard that they might see at some of those camps. So they got to be able to demonstrate their ability to catch those passes, you know, at a moment's notice, but also be able to finish in traffic. And when you see them do that in that setting, and they're providing some great marketing fodder for themselves.
Yeah, no doubt, because when you see big men at these high-profile camps where you see the top of the top athletes from your own class competing in, I mean, you gotta figure that these guys are going to be tall, lengthy, and they can finish under the basket. But the other intangibles that go along with the game, you know, some of these guys, might not be playing with the best guards in with their respective high school teams. But to be able to go to some of these camps where these guards are really going at it and really feeding them great passes in the block, and helping their own cause really helps them expand their game.
Yeah, and on the flip side, you know, you might have a guard that's not used to playing with a dominant post player or a guy that can do some of the things that some of their camp cohorts can do. So as a guard, you got to be able to show you can not only score, but can you create opportunities and feed the horse when you have one on your team.
Yeah, another steal by Jerick Mitchell. Great defense by Josh Okoji to get back and prevent the easy layup from Mitchell. And Okoji's going the other way with it now, leading the offense and taking it hard to the rim through the Shiloh defense in the easy lane. He made it look easy. It wasn't easy, but Josh Okoji makes a lot of things look easy.
Definitely made that easy button bucket right there. Made it a 28-41 game in the process. He's having a solid one so far. Makes it a 12-point advantage here with a minute 45 and counting left to play. Fleming, he's still going down shooting, man, but you can tell fatigue definitely playing a factor.
Yeah, no doubt. Fleming's played the majority of this game, too. Hasn't had much rest at all.
Nice work on the inside. That's Stavion Stevenson. Again, told you he's the helmet and lunch pail guy on the inside for Cedar Shoals. Able to get a nice bucket there. Question is it too little, too late? We'll see. 30-41, stranger things have happened. We'll be back here on SUV TV after this short break. Back from the timeout, under the minute 30 mark here, Marcus Burnett joined by Will Marlowe as we come down the final stretch of this one.
Oh, Josh Okoji with the quick between the legs, taking it hard to the hole, misses layup, but you got to love what you're seeing out of him. But, you know, I also love what I'm seeing out of Cedar Shoals. You know, we haven't seen their shots really knock it down here, but they've never really gotten out of their element. They've still been moving the ball, working the shot clock, trying to find their shot, and as long as they do that, the shots will fall.
Yep, I don't care how good of a shooter you are, how good of a team you are, sometimes you just have a game where it's you know, it's not falling. And also, like you mentioned, the caveat, giving credit to the Shiloh defense. They've had a big part to do with that. And then if you know Cedar Shoals as a program, you want to be in this type of league, because even though you want to be able to win, it's always a learning tool. You're in it for the marathon and not the sprint. It's easy to have a sprint. You could go undefeated in this shot clock league and it not amount to anything if you're not prepared for the season. Nice jumper there from the top of the key. That was number 7, Arthur Jones.
Yeah, I think Arthur Jones might have shot that one from the parking lot. My Lord, did it have some distance on it. He really had to jump into that shot, and he drained it.
Yeah, he did, man. Shot that one from Coach Sharman White's parking spot. He's back in town from USA Basketball. I can't park in it anymore.
Hey, I bet that's the first thing he checked when he got back here, if anyone was in his parking spot.
I started to joke with Coach, man, but he's the mayor of Lithonia, man. So I didn't even make that quib. 49 seconds left to play, 33-41. That is your score. Good game from Khalil Richard as well.
Oh yeah, Khalil Richard really been a huge benefit to this Shiloh lead. Draining open shots, but creating a lot of opportunities for the big men down low. Creating some pick and rolls, giving it to TJ Massenberg. When you get Massenberg under the block, he's going to finish a lot of the time, or at least draw a foul.
Yeah, Massenberg and Dijon Waters were nice on the inside for the Generals. Real general-like games there on the inside for both of those guys.
Yeah, and mentioning the Shiloh team, all these guys can play in multiple positions. You know, you see Josh Okoji down low, but Josh Okoji brings the ball up a lot of time for Shiloh. Nice defense there by Cedar Shoals, double-teaming Josh Okoji, forcing the turnover. Down 8, 30 seconds left. It might be a little too much too late, but Cedar Shoals not going to give up.
You respect how they're playing. They're still, you know, out there scrapping after it on the defensive end. Got to feel like you're never out of it unless there are 3 zeros on the clock. You know, it's kind of like that Paul Pierce factor, that Paul Pierce approach. This past year against the Hawks, man, it seemed like that guy was, if he felt like he could do anything to be able to get them into a tie or win that game, it was just a matter of going out and doing it.
Man, it's crazy, too, that he's been doing that for his whole career, and it's crazy that he's still doing it now.
He goes for the throat, man. He's not interested in giving you a body blow or giving you something just to stifle you. He wants to go for the head. Was that game 5 there in that series against the Hawks? And I think that they were only down 2. And I kept telling my wife, I guarantee you Paul Pierce goes for the 3 here. He has no interest whatsoever in the 2-pointer and going to overtime. And sure enough, he goes in the corner, knocks down a 3, and at that time says series to the Atlanta bench. Follow-up to him saying game on the buzzer beater against them earlier in that series. But thanks to Al Horford with a big man rebound and a putback, he thwarted his plans there that night.
Yeah, and I forgot who the Wizards took down in the first series of the first round.
I believe it was the Toronto Raptors.
The Raptors, right. Yeah. And a lot of the Raptors players came out and said a huge reason to why they lost was Paul Pierce. Paul Pierce was just able to get under his skin, and that was a huge reason why the Wizards took that first series.
He scored a lot there against the Hawks. He'd come in, he'd have 6 points, 2 of 7 field goals, but find a way for one of those 2 to be a game tie or possibly a game winner. Appreciate you joining us here on SUV TV. We'll take about an hour break and be back with the 8 o'clock game, Miller Grove versus Jonesboro. Appreciate you joining us here on SUV TV.